So what is corporate evil? Well, it's when a corporation knowingly does some bad thing. Apple and Foxconn for your employees, right? So that's the Chinese factory worker that, you know, we all want Steve Jobs to be reincarnated as. So Foxconn, like, people, conditions are so bad in this factory that people are killing themselves. And the management's like, well, we'll just give them a 30% raise in salary. Like, you know, conditions are still miserable. It's still dangerous. It's still a horrible place to work, but you'll make even more money for having your soul crushed. So why does this stuff happen? Well, it comes down to greed, right? Primarily from investors and holding companies that put tons and tons of pressure on corporations for that double-digit growth. If you lower costs, so you cut corners, no safety, no any of that stuff, it makes it easier to turn a profit, easier to pay back a quarter of a point on lumber stock. And that's primarily it. We don't want to spend a lot of money to do stuff. We just want to sit back, do nothing, and collect big fat stacks of cash. Well, you can be a shell company. You can be a company that doesn't actually own anything, right? And that's just a target kind of floating out there. And you can use that to move things into it, move things out of it. You can make all these phony agreements with this company that really only exists in a folder downtown. You can also do the opposite. You can be a company with all sorts of holdings, all kinds of stuff, all this money, all this stock, all these things, but doesn't really do anything. Both of these are examples of companies that have no identity, no brand, no product. So a brand isn't a company, which means that you can just, you know, if your brand or your company gets into enough trouble in the news, you just change the name, right? And you keep doing what you're doing, right? Blackwater shot all those civilians in Iraq, right? They became XE. WorldCom, that was a crooked corporation. Thank God MCI's here to make everything right. It's the same company. So Philip Morris, right? They make cigarettes. Cigarettes cause cancer. Cancer kills people. Philip Morris is bad. Now they're Altria. So how do we get even? Well, we tell the press, right? We leak documents. We get whistleblowers to come forward. We trust mainstream media to investigate these problems thoroughly. And so this is why the press is important. The only problem is they're corporations just like the dudes that cause all this problem. So a news organization is a business, right? Only their product isn't news. Their product is us. We watch the news. We tune in. We go to CNN.com. We tune into Newsline. We tune into these different things. And, you know, and then they sell ads. So your eyeballs are the product, and they sell it for money via ads. And who buys the ads? Corporations have all of this money. That money translates to influence, and that influence is executed all over a lot of things. And this is a conflict of interest. So where's the government in all of this? You elect Congress to make laws. You vote for Congress. Your vote counts. Democracy is important. And then you get your dudes into office, and then nothing really changes. That's because Congress just, like, subdivides into committees. All that, you know, all the big decisions are made by committees. Not all of Congress can just hash out what all that stuff is. And you don't vote for the committees. You can, you know, campaign for your guy to get into office, you know, because he's going to clean up Wall Street. But if he doesn't land on the finance committees, on all the economic committees, you know, you just fired that vote out into the ether. And it gets worse. So Congress then creates these government agencies. These are run by appointees. You don't vote for the guy that leads the FCC. You don't vote for the guy that leads the EPA. You don't vote for the guy that does these things. They're appointed either by Congress or by the president. And sometimes, like in the case of the Federal Reserve and that sort of thing, it's like a hybrid. Part of it's kind of a company, but it's kind of the government. But it doesn't matter because you didn't vote for it. They govern specific industries, you know, transportation, energy, communications, and whatever. And so you need experts from the field to come run that stuff. Well, where do you get those experts from? From the industries that those agencies are regulating. And so these agencies make the rules that govern the industries, but they're staffed by people from the industry. The congressional committees need to, you know, it costs a lot of money to get reelected, right? And if you're already in office, you tend to stay in office. And so these guys can run year after year after term after term after term, and they create these, like, industry relationships. They go in and out of, or they make buddies with these people that they then put into these administrative agencies. And, you know, and then it's like, well, you know, Chris, you're talking out of your ass because we have the courts, right? the courts. You can always sue someone, take them into court, and all that. Well, the judges aren't experts on, you know, banking and telecommunications and transportation and all this stuff. So those guys defer to the judgment of the people from these agencies. And so what you have is a judiciary that says, well, you know, I mean, these guys from the agencies, they know what they're talking about. You know, they get to make the laws that govern those specific agencies. We'll just go with what they say. And those guys, of course, are from the industries that they're supposed to be governing, right? And then you have your special interests, right? So these are big corporations with lots of money, right? And up at the top, because it costs a lot of money to get reelected, they funnel money into election campaigns, and they get appointed, not elected, you don't vote for them, to run government agencies. So, you know, in this little, you know, this little three-sided triangle, you're locked out. You get no say, right? It's really depressing. So the game's rigged for the corporations to win, right? Yeah, the only winning move is not to play. So, so part three, this is how we fight corporate evil. And the truth is, you just really can't. Okay.
I think a basic question that we have to ask ourselves is who foments the system? And that is what I call the corporatocracy, which are very few, primarily men, who run our biggest corporations. And through them, they control the United States government and every other one in the world, too, that they want to control. And in fact, at the highest levels, the people in the government and the people at the top of the big corporations are one and the same. They go through what we call the revolving door. So one year somebody's president of a huge corporation, and the next year he or she is secretary of state or vice president or even president. And so this system is controlled by what I call the corporatocracy.
I'm John Perkins. I'm a U.S. citizen, born in the United States, raised in the United States. I'm a former economic hitman. We work very much like some of the hitmen for the mafia, because we're looking for a favor later. And mafia people have done this, and gangsters have done this for ages. We just do it on a very large level with governments, with countries, huge level. And we're much more professional. We do this in many ways, but perhaps the most common is that economic hitmen will identify a country that has resources our corporations covet, like oil. And then we arrange a huge loan to that country from the World Bank or one of its sister organizations. But the money never actually goes to the country. Instead, it goes to our own corporations to build big infrastructure projects in that country. Things that benefit a few very rich people in that country, as well as our own corporations, but don't help the majority of the people who are too poor. But these people, the poor people, are left holding a huge debt, and it's so huge that they can't possibly repay it. But in the process of trying to repay it, they create a situation where they can't afford to have good health programs or educational programs. So we economic hitmen go back in and we say, listen, you owe us a lot of money, you can't pay your debts, so give us a pound of flesh. Sell your oil real cheap to our oil companies, or vote with us on the next critical United Nations vote, or send troops in support of ours to someplace in the world, like Iraq. And in that way, we've really managed to create this empire. Because the fact of the matter is, we write the laws. We control the World Bank. We control the IMF. We even control the United Nations to a large degree. And so we write the laws. So the things economic hitmen are not illegal. Putting countries in huge debt and then demanding favors in return, that's not illegal. It should be. It isn't. Sometimes we economic hitmen fail to corrupt leaders of other countries, as I failed with Omar Torrijos in Panama and Jaime Roldos in Ecuador. It doesn't often happen, but when it does, then the jackals are sent in. And these are people who overthrow governments or assassinate their leaders. On the few occasions where neither the economic hitmen nor the jackals are successful, then and only then do we send in the military. And this is exactly what happened in Iraq. The economic hitmen could not corrupt Saddam Hussein, could not bring him around. The jackals couldn't take him out. And so the military was sent in.
In order for
a relatively small percentage of the population to have a lot of wealth, you've got to have a very large percentage of the population essentially acting as slaves. They've got to be impoverished. So as long as we live in a system that honors that, in a system that requires slavery, in essence slavery, to move it forward, we're going to have poverty, because it's absolutely to the advantage of the corporatocracy, of the people who control our biggest businesses and corporations, to have a mass of poor people around the world that they can draw on for labor, that they can draw on to steal their resources, whether it's oil or diamonds or coltan or whatever the resources are. And as long as those people remain impoverished, as we call it, then they're at the mercy of those of us with wealth, and we get to exploit them.
At the very top of the investment hierarchy on this planet, you have intergenerational pools of capital that are controlled and owned by private families. They're unbelievably centralized, and they operate through a whole series of bureaucracies, which you describe, which is the, you know, the central banks and the insurance industry and the Bilderbergers and the Council on Foreign Relations. And there's umpteen billion secret societies coordinating all this stuff because it's a big planet. If you look at all the people in our society, Alex, they're saying this is wrong and this is wrong. You know, they're talking about the money's wrong or the corruption's wrong or Wall Street's wrong or 9/11's wrong or vaccines are wrong. All of those things are symptoms. They're symptoms of the fundamental problem, which is a governance problem, which is who's in charge and why are they destroying significant amounts of freedom and wealth?
Chaos, mayhem, destabilization are the friends of exploitation. And so if you can have internal problems in a country, then it's ripe for exploitation. You know, it's the old divide and conquer. So for example, in the Middle East, the fact that Sunnis and Shiites and Israelis all are at each other's throats works to the advantage of oil companies, because the divide and conquer, if they all came together and found the common enemy, which is the exploiting people, then the oil companies wouldn't have the chance. But as long as they can keep it destabilized, I mean, the corporations do everything they can to foment turmoil, mayhem, instability, chaos there, and to keep the information from reaching the American public, from even reaching the press, because that serves their interests best.
We have the left versus the right, sort of embodied today in the Republican Party supposedly on the right and the Democrat Party supposedly on the left. Now, here's a choice, isn't there? Well, why is it, if this is such a choice, that we go from Republicans to Democrats, and then 4 years or 8 years later we go back to Republicans again, and we keep doing this? We've been doing this since World War I. How come the country keeps moving in the same direction all the time, deeper and deeper and deeper into collectivism? They believe that the group is more important than the individual, for example, and the individual must be sacrificed, if necessary, for the greater good of the greater number. They believe that the state should be all-powerful and that the people should obey the state for the greater good of the greater number and all of that sort of thing. They believe that rights are granted by the state. They're not part of the human being. They're not God-given. They're not entrenched in his body and soul. They have to be granted by the state. All of these things, and you look at them one by one, communists and fascists and Nazis and socialists, they all believe that. So wherein lies the conflict, you see? And I began to question that. And I realized that it's partly a trick. In fact, I think it's a huge trick. It's a great scam, because people even today are thinking that they have to choose between the right or the left, not realizing that no matter which way they go, they've accepted basically the same ideology underneath. We find that the Republican Party and the Democrat Party both are pretty much in the hands of a relatively small group of people, with a membership of about 4,000. It's called the Council on Foreign Relations. These are the people that are really pulling the strings in both the Republican and the Democrat Party. Yes, I did see the clip in which Hillary Clinton says that, I think she was saying it was nice to be so close to the headquarters of the Council on Foreign Relations, because she didn't have to go very far to find out what to think and how to act on certain issues, or something to that effect.
But it's good to have an outpost of the council right here down the street from the State Department. We get a lot of advice from the council, so this will mean I won't have as far to go to be told what we should be doing and how we should think about the future.
I'm sure she's been embarrassed by that statement and probably has issued some kind of a qualifying statement that, well, she didn't mean it quite that way. But the fact of the matter is, I think she did mean it. You just don't get the green light to move up in politics unless the switch is thrown in the building there at the Council on Foreign Relations office. They're brought in and they're treated very nicely, and then they're asked some questions to see how they think and how they would act under certain circumstances, and what is their view on this policy and that policy. And if their answers are acceptable, they get the green light. Council says, okay, this is a man that we can trust, that we can support. If they give the wrong answers, I don't think they're ever going to get any kind of a green light. And so people like Hillary Clinton know, even at that elevated position, Hillary Clinton, you'd say, was one of the big movers and shakers. Compared to the Council on Foreign Relations, she's not. She's a small fish. And she knows that she's got to get the approval of the CFR. There's a fellow by the name of Carol Quigley, who's a former history professor at Georgetown University. By the way, he's was the mentor of William Clinton. And he wrote several books about this group of people and their origins and their roots coming from Europe and England in particular. And he comes to a very interesting point in one of his books where he says, okay, this is the way the real world is. He said, how is it that we collectivists, we elitists, how can we rule the world when at the same time we want to let the average person think that they're living in a, quote, democracy? They're living in a system where their vote counts. And he answers the question brilliantly. He said, it's very simple. You've got to have two major political parties, and they'll both have the same major goals, the same basic fundamental principles. And they'll argue with each other on the surface with slogans and leadership and style and all of that sort of thing. He said, but we will control them both. When you understand this history and this reality, you look at it and you say, well, yes, we've got a left wing and a right wing, but they're just opposite wings of the same ugly bird. And that bird is called collectivism.
We have people that think about the conspiracy theories of people like you. You would be a poster child for these people because you have served on the board of the Council on Foreign Relations. You helped start the Trilateral Commission, and you've been to the Bilderberger groups. Are people too close in this world, people in business, too close to the governments?
Well, you know, there is such a thing as insidious influence. And the question is, how does it operate? Does it involve bribery? And does it involve some sort of psychological domination of individuals? I don't believe in this notion of some sort of secret societies controlling people. But of course, in any political system, there are sort of over the table and under the table arrangements. Maybe that reinforces the conspiracy theory that somehow or other we're pulling the strings from behind the scene.
It's good to be back at the Council on Foreign Relations. As Pete mentioned, I've been a member for a long time and was actually a director for some period of time. I never mentioned that when I was campaigning for re-election back home in Wyoming.
It's been reported that you and your wife are in the globalist CFR, which is a Council on Foreign Relations. I'd like to know if that is true.
I don't know if I'm a official member. I've spoken there before. It basically is just a forum where a bunch of people talk about foreign policy.
Today, the CFR maintains that its goal is to increase America's understanding of the world. However, the actual objective of this highly exclusive club is revealed by the rare admissions of the insiders themselves. For 2 years, Professor Carol Quigley is allowed to examine the confidential papers and secret records of this network. Quigley reveals that these men aim to create a world system of financial control in private hands, able to dominate the political system of each country and the economy of the world as a whole.
In 1928, Edward Bernays wrote, "The conscious and intelligent manipulation of the organized habits and opinions of the masses is an important element in democratic society. Those who manipulate this unseen mechanism of society constitute an invisible government, which is the true ruling power of our country." Bernays believed that people were inherently stupid. They must be controlled. Democracy must be shaped, or at least prevented from functioning fully. To do this, Bernays went to the teaching of his uncle, Sigmund Freud. Freud believed that people were influenced by unconscious desires. With this knowledge, Bernays concluded that you couldn't influence the public by appealing to rational thought, but instead, their irrational emotions. While the name Edward Bernays is unknown to most Americans, he's had a major impact on our lives. He worked for the Wilson, Hoover, and Eisenhower administration. He rubbed shoulders with the most powerful men in America. And he was employed by almost every major corporation in the U.S., including New Jersey Bell Telephone, Procter & Gamble, American Tobacco Company, General Electric, Dodge Motors, CVS, and Bethlehem Steel.
Today, an elite handful of individuals define the agendas that are supported by the empire of establishment news. In short, they seek total and quiet control of the entire world.
We mustn't be caught by surprise by our own advancing technology. This has happened again and again in history. Technology has advanced, and this changes social condition, and suddenly people have found themselves in a situation which they didn't foresee and doing all sorts of things they didn't really want to do.
Why is it that the wrong people will use these various devices and for the wrong motives?
These are all instruments for obtaining power, and obviously the passion for power is one of the most moving passions that exist in man, and after all, this is all democracies are based on the proposition that power is very dangerous and that it's extremely important not to let any one man or any one small group have too much power for too long a time. After all, what are the British and American constitutions except devices for limiting power? And all these new devices are extremely efficient instruments for the imposition of power by small groups over larger masses.
How can we preserve the integrity and reassert the value of the human individual?
It's a question of education. I think it's terribly important to insist on individual values. There is a tendency, as you probably read a book by White, The Organization Man, where he speaks about the new type of group morality, group ethic, which speaks about the group as though the group were somehow more important than the individual. But this seems, as far as I'm concerned, to be in contradiction with what we know about the genetical makeup of human beings, that every human being is unique. And it is, of course, on this genetical basis that the whole idea of the value of freedom is based. And I think it's extremely important for us to stress this in all our educational life. And I would say it's also very important to teach people to be on their guard against the sort of verbal booby traps into which they're always being led, to analyze the kind of things that are said to them.